Okay, so the title of the presentation is Getting Further with Camel and Quarkus, and the idea is really to step into the shoes of a day-to-day Camel Quarkus developer and review some useful tips, useful features, I would say. And there is another part, like I would like to dig a bit more inside the native mode, dig further. So my name is Alexandre Gallis, and I'm working as a senior software engineer at Red Hat. I'm also a Camel contributor, those days mainly focusing on Camel Quarkus. Yeah, here I have some tiny URLs, so I will pass them after the presentation in the chat so that you will have access to all the information you would like to. So let's talk about the plan first. I would like to onboard everyone. So a quick reminder about Camel and Quarkus. And most of you may have already seen the content from the previous session, so I will be quick, but let's say have a good summary. After that, we will work on a local project on my machine. And this is where we will step into the shoes of a day-to-day Camel Quarkus developer and review some useful tips. And the last part, we will move to a Kubernetes cluster, so a deployment with Knative. And we see what happens when we put some memory constraints on this cluster with on-demand provisioning. So this is for the end of the demonstration. But first, a reminder about Camel. So really quickly, this is Camel is a Swiss knife for integration. We want to integrate two systems, for instance, system A, system B. We want to make them communicate together. So what key capability we need? We need to be able to extract some messages from system A, and this is built in Camel with access to more than 300 technologies. Then we would like to apply some kind of standard operation, some recipes that are answers to common integration problems. We call them enterprise integration patterns. And last part, the idea is to produce to system B, to the target system, and we can do this also with 300 plus technologies. Then, on the last line of this slide, you see the pseudocode of a typical Camel route. And we will consume from a SQL database, and with a single URI, we'll define the SQL records we would like to consume. Then we will apply an enterprise integration pattern named filter, and with a predicate, define what's useful and what's not. The last part is just to, in a typical Camel route, to send to a target system, and where we will send to an Amazon S3 service. And that's really as simple and as readable as that. Now, when it comes to deployment, you have multiple options. You can deploy as a Spring Boot application, you can deploy as a Keras bundle, and we can also deploy as a Quarkus application. And this is the focus for today. So what is Quarkus? Quarkus, it's a Java framework, but more oriented toward cloud deployment, Knative, and so on. And the idea is really, the philosophy is to do as much as possible at build time, okay? Quarkus is not the kind of person which prepare for himself at the last minutes. It's preparing far ahead. There is also this idea of developer joy, and we will see the demo in action during this demonstration. Another interesting aspect is that Quarkus is reusing good old Java libraries and specification, and we will see some CDI tricks used in the day-to-day life of a Camel Quarkus developer. And now concerning the deployment, you have two options. You can deploy in JVM mode and in native mode. And I will expand about that a bit later on. I think right now it's time to start a demonstration and to see things running. So in this project, which is prepared for the demonstration, we will use the REST DSL. It's also working in Camel Quarkus, and moreover, we will use it in XML. And as such, we define with this line a simple REST endpoint that will listen for incoming GET requests on the UI/steps. Then the incoming requests will be forwarded to a route, and here we can use the typical Camel definition of a route. So what do we do? Set body constant to a value of step one. So this is simply an Hello World application returning an ARF-coded body. So right now, I would like to see my prototype running. And I can do maven Quarkus dev for this. And this is where we will enter the dev mode of Quarkus. So basically, it will compile the application, start the project, and listen for changes on any kind of sources, be it Java files and so on. And the idea is that every time a change is needed on the source, Quarkus will automatically reload, and we will have that way a constant feedback about our development. For instance, if I try to invoke an HTTP request here, I have my R-coded answer step one. So here we go, our development loop is in place. And typically, if we go back to the shoes of a day-to-day Camel Quarkus developer, most of the time we face some integration challenges and we would like to use some custom Java code. So in Camel, we do this by the bin component. So in Camel Quarkus, it's called an extension. An extension is wrapping a component and adding capability to run on top of Quarkus. So here we use the bin extension and we need to locate a step to bin. It will be in the registry. And actually, in order to put it in the registry, we will use this @name annotation, so standard CDI annotation implemented by Quarkus. So that way, Camel will be able to bind the incoming exchange to this method, the step method. And you see what's happening. We just suffix the content with step two. So we will return an hard-coded value, let's say, of step one, step two. As we are here, I would like us to keep attention about 2 points. You see a static initializer. This one, it will pop up during the demonstration, so I explain it now. It's like simulating a long configuration task taking 3 seconds. And we will see it will pop up during the demonstration, so please remind this as it will have some consequences. And another point, as we are here, this @register for reflection annotation, just keep this in mind. I will explain later on what's happening there. So at this stage, if I run my HTTP command again, I have step one, step two return. My step two bin is invoked. Well, good. But in a way, it would be interesting to be able to test this and specifically mocking the bin, substituting the bin in order for test purpose will be a really good feature. And this we can do with it at inject mode annotation. It's a kind of mix with of Quarkus, JUnit, and Mockito. And at the end of the day, it allows us to write statements like this, meaning that when we will invoke the step method, then we will return a substituted value here, step one mock. The good news is that we can test this via REST assured with a simple statement where we will expect a status code of 200 and the body to be step one mock, the body substituted. So if I run this as a JUnit test, what's happening? It started. And then here we see our long configuration task taking 3 seconds. So the static initializer that will pop up during the demonstration. And at the end of the day, the test is run and our expectations are fulfilled. So everything is fine. So we have seen now to include some Java code and even mock it with @inject mock. So at this stage, most developers, we would like to use some logs. And here, we use the log extension, defining the test category. So how would this be working? I invoke yet again my HTTP request, but this time I see that I have a log more which is there. However, this log is not really clear. We have the exchange pattern, we have the body type, and we don't really want this, we want something clearer. So how do we do this? In a way, we would like to tune the log component. And there is a way to do this by means of Java code here with an observer method. So the idea is very simple. We will use this @observe annotation from CDI. And listen for component add event. So meaning each time a component, so a component, it's like the timer component, here's the log component, the big component. Each time a component is added into Camel, we will be able to intercept this. And this is what we do here. So the implementation is not really what is interesting for us today, but we will discard some useless content like the body type and the exchange pattern. And at this stage, if I invoke yet again my request, I see that now the log is clearer. So we have been able to tune our components by means of Java code. Yeah, next step. Yeah, obviously, we reach the end of this prototype and we would like to produce to a target technology. Here, this will be a NAT server and we will publish on a given topic. Now, look at this. We have some extra options. Secure equals true. It just means that we will want to communicate with the NAT server over SSL. And in this respect, we will need to provide an SSL context parameter bin. And here, with this notation, hashtag SSL, the bin is named SSL in the registry. So we need to provide this. And how we will do this? With another pattern, the producer method pattern. And here, we will use at names SSL context parameters, and the name of the method SSL will be the name by convention of the bin registered in the registry. So the implementation is quite classical, but it's not really interesting for us. I want you to pay attention, please. On this, we need to have a keystore.jks resource and here a truster.jks file. They are needed in order to communicate with the NAT server over SSL. And I really want to stress the point here that they are stored as resources inside the jar, so they are shipped with the jar. Please keep this in mind. Well, at this stage, we should have something running, and no, it's not running. Yeah, no servers configured, it must be specified. So we will need to take a few steps back and to remind that in the bottom shell here, we have a NAT server which is running, and this one is listing on port 4222. And then we didn't never have told this to Camel. So in a way, we would like to tune the NAT component here, define the server's option. So it should be possible to do this by means of Java code. Yes, but in this case, this is really simple and we have another notation which is also working in Camel Quarkus, Camel components NAT server. So meaning we will define the servers on the NAT component in Camel. The value will be localhost 4222. And right now, if I don't mistake, if the application is restarted first, so yeah, it has been restarted. If I invoke my HTTP requests, I now have my step one, step two hard-coded body, which is there, my clean log, and my message payload in the NAT server communicated over SSL. So we have reached quite a good state for our demonstration. Maybe it's time, to have a look at the deployment. So here we will use Maven clean package. And if you remember, with Quarkus, we have two options in order to deploy, in JVM mode and in native mode. Here, we will directly switch to the native mode, and this command will take a bit of time. So this is the moment to have a recap with JVM mode versus native mode. And at first, the JVM mode, in JVM mode, Quarkus is producing a jar. It's not really a typical jar, actually, it's a fast jar, a jar which is optimized to start quickly and use less memory, so more adapted in a container world. That's true, but in native mode, we are producing a native executable, and this one, you will see, it has really, really some good properties. Yeah, if you compare the experience concerning build and debug, so in JVM mode, it's pretty much the same as with typical Java framework. In native mode, it's different. The build is slow, and we are currently experimenting this. We will see how much time it takes at the end of the day. And concerning the debug, it could be seen as a bit more difficult because, for instance, you need to use tools like GDB in order to debug a native executable. And moreover, the debugging in Quarkus native is not really, let's say, very handy. Okay, you have the basic features, but it's not really complete. And the main idea behind this is that most of the time, I would say, I don't know, 95% of the time, your application will behave the same in JVM mode and in native mode. So as such, you could as well debug the JVM mode, and in the very rare situation where the native mode differs, then you will use GDB and the debugging, the native debugging. A core aspect of Quarkus is about the boot time and memory usage. And it's really fair to say that Quarkus in JVM mode is already doing fine. The boot is fast and the memory usage is smaller. And in native mode, it's going another dimension. The boot time is really instant and the memory usage so tiny. Yeah, I would like to have a word about performance here. Really, the key point is about the JIT compiler. In JVM mode, you have the JIT compiler, meaning that your application, the JIT compiler, is capable of optimizing your application on the fly, depending the current execution profile. So this is quite dynamic. And in native mode, we lose a lot of dynamicity. We lose this. So on the one end, we are not able to optimize on the fly, but what we gain the cost of the JIT compiler infrastructure. So it means that we will save quite some memory. And as such, for the same memory budget, we will have a better container density. And the key example is for the same memory budget, you may, for instance, deploy a single container in JVM mode and maybe 3 to 6, I don't know, containers in native mode. So in native mode, the containers will be smaller and moreover, spreadable on multiple nodes, you know. So something's really fine-grained, actually. So in summary, the JVM mode is more oriented for a single long-running service. And the native mode, it will be more, you know, give its best in some short running services. So let's see our build. And it's currently running. If we take a look at what's happening, there is a lot of treatments. And we see, for instance, here that we have simulating a long configuration task taking 3 seconds. So it just means that we are still at build time. The build is not yet finished. And we already have executed the static initializer, meaning that our configuration, the long configuration task taking 3 seconds, more or less, we will do this once and for all at build time, meaning that we may gain some startup for the container while in native mode. Okay, so it's still taking a bit of time. Okay, the idea, we will let this finished, and I would like to show, because what will happen, there will be an issue, actually. And this issue is that the key store, the GKS resources, the key store, the GKS resources, which are there, those resources are not stored inside the native executable. So even if I finish the build, then it will fail when running. So I give you the solution right now. We will need to use this Quarkus native resources include. So this is a property. And this property, the idea is that it will select some files to be embedded inside the native executable. And this is the solution for this issue. So now that the build is finished, I will show you the issue. We launch the native executable and we have a message. The keystore.jks file is not stored. Okay. So we already have seen the solution. So first, what I will do, I will trigger another build. And you see how much time it takes. So a few steps back, the solution here is to provide this property. This is a Quarkus property, Quarkus native resources includes. And we define the set of resources that we would like to embed inside an active executable. But this is a sign that we need to dig a bit more in the native mode in order to understand what's happening under the hood, because this is it could be quite surprising what you are not used to. So let's dig a bit. What is the native mode? The native mode, actually, it's just based on another kind of virtual machine. It's named Substrate from the Graal project. And this match, this virtual machine, it sees the world in a different way, with a different assumption, actually. It is called the closed world assumption. In this context, closed world, it just means that everything is known at build time. That's really as simple as that. It's simple, but it's quite powerful. When you think about it, if you know everything at build time, then you can maybe boot a big part of your application at build time. I don't know, parsing some configuration files, executing some static initializers that will behave the same at build time and at runtime. Maybe some things you will not be able to do them at build time. I don't know, opening a connection to a database. Obviously, the database will not be able at build time. So this is the first thing. You are able to boot a big part of your application at build time. And for instance, we have seen already the static initializer. So now, what we can do, we can take a snapshot of our application startup memory. And then bits for bits, we store this inside the native executable. So we have a first part with, let's say, the warmed up memory of our application inside the native executable. Now there is another thing we can do. We know everything at build time. So we can actually perform a static code analysis and determine, select only the code which is strictly needed in order to run our application. And that way, could you imagine, we will like be able to filter out all parts of the JDK if they are not used. We are able to filter, I don't know, unused methods and unused fields inside our own development, inside our third-party libraries, and inside the whole stack of our application, actually. Now, if we would like to start our native executable, so we have two parts. We have, let's say, our warmed-up memory. We have the code which is strictly needed to run the application. So in order to boot this, what we can do, we can take the memory, put this inside the RAM, and then execute the code which is strictly needed. And that is the recipe for instant boot, tiny memory, and also low disk usage. So far, so great. But there is always a flip side. And here the flip side is that you have more developer responsibility. For instance, we have seen an example with the resources that includes patterns. The key aspect here is that none of Quarkus, Camel Quarkus, and GraalVM have been able to deduce that those resources will be needed at runtime. And as such, this is left as a developer responsibility. And actually, we have seen another example. We have seen this at register for reflection annotation. You remember in the step to bin code. And here the key idea is that Camel can use some Java code by the means of the bin component, the bin extension. But for this, it needs to use Java reflection. And reflection is no more than using new code at runtime, loading new code at runtime, actually. And as such, breaking the closed world assumption. So the idea is that in a way, you need to have a flag in order to say this code will be needed to be included at build time in the static analysis. And this is the purpose of this at register for reflection annotation. We have seen two examples here, but honestly, it applies to most Java dynamic features. Now, the good news is that most of the time, Camel Quarkus can manage things for you. For instance, the restis.xml file, this is the resources where we have stored our application logic. We didn't have to define that this is explicitly needed in the native executable. And the reason is that Camel Quarkus is able to deduce this because obviously this is where the integration logic resides, so it will forcefully be needed. You deploy your route, you need the route definition. But from time to time, it's left as the developer responsibility, and we have seen the example of the certs, the JKS resources. The key aspect being that none of the build tools, Camel Quarkus, Quarkus, and GraalVM, were able to determine that this is needed at runtime. Okay, let's see if our build is going well. Oh, it took some things like 5 minutes. So let's start our application here. Now it's running. It started in a matter of 500 milliseconds. If I invoke my HTTP request, I have my step one, step two contents, my clear log, and the message payload communicating over SSL to the NAT server. So we are done. Our prototype is okay. And I hope we have reviewed some key features of Camel Quarkus. Now, what I would like to do, I would like to move to another part. We will move to a Kubernetes cluster. So let's talk a bit more what happened when we deploy and the options. So actually, I am not logged in. I will need to do something. So I will need to do some things like okay. And as such, I should have admin. Is it working? Yes, it's working. So it's an OpenShift cluster. And I didn't have to show my password. Very good. So this is an OpenShift cluster. OpenShift is just Kubernetes with goodies. One of the goodies here is that we are able to see the list of Knative services already deployed. We have four of them, and they are accessible via four distinct URLs. Now let's review what a typical such a service would like. It's really simple. Honestly, it's really for demo purpose, really a simple Hello World application. We will consume an incoming HTTP request and then provide an hard-coded value. So a bit the same way we have done in the local demo, in the local project here, we will have four Knative services consuming an HTTP GET resources and answering an hard-coded body value. The idea is that we will answer Hello Camel Quarkus in native mode, Hello Camel Quarkus in JVM mode, and the same for the by services. So if we count, it's four services. They are deployed as Knative services already in the cluster so that we will be able to see them running. And as such, yeah, the idea is that on the upper shell, I will have commands like Hello JVM. Really simple, it's an alias, and it will invoke some HTTP traffic for the Knative services, which is answering Hello Camel Quarkus in JVM mode. And we will have four alias: Hello JVM by JVM, Hello Native by Native. Now let's have a look in the bottom shell here. We have the list of pods which are currently running in order to save our requests. So most of us already know that Camel Quarkus, there is no pods which is currently running because Knative is able to scale to zero. So if we want to see something, we will need to trigger some HTTP traffic with Hello JVM. And we do this. What's happening? We have a deployment provisioning on the fly. And our first request answered in something like 6 or 7 seconds. Subsequently, if we invoke Hello JVM another time, the execution is really much faster because the undeployment, the on-demand provisioning is already there. The deployment is there. So what really matters is the time to answer the first request. Okay. Now, if I invoke Hello Native, exactly the same kind of thing will happen, but with a notable differences. Here, it takes only 2 or 3 seconds, and we have saved, if you remember, the static initializer. 3 seconds, it's executed only once and for all. And here we see how it behaves. It's more than 3 seconds saved because you have these 3 seconds and perhaps more from other optimization. So this is for the boot time effect. But there is also another point which is interesting, the memory effect. And for this, I will first need to explain the memory quota. In the bottom shell, we have defined with Kubernetes a memory quota. Memory quota, it's a Kubernetes feature. And here, it will operate on the default namespace. The idea is that in the default namespace, the quota will list the memory requests from all containers and sum that. Okay, so we will have the sum of the memory requests from all containers. So the memory requests of the containers is just the amount of memory they are consuming in order to start. Okay. So the idea is that we will count how much memory it is. Currently, it is for 400 MB because the deployment is there. The deployment will step down, and we will see another aspect, the hard limit. And this is where some things will happen. We will have 500 MB of hard limit, meaning the memory quota, 500 MB, we can never exceed this hard limit. So I put a memory constraint in my deployment, but actually, memory constraint could come because of a budget, memory costs a lot. And so we have this memory constraint. Okay, let's review. I invoke LOGVM again, on-demand provisioning, we are used to this. And now we pay attention, we are using 300 MB of memory. Conversely, if I invoke something like by in JVM mode, this would be another 300 MB of memory. So 300 plus 300, 600, maybe it's higher than the limits. What will happen? Okay, the better is to test it real life. What's happening? Nothing. It's perfectly normal. Nothing is happening because Knative is detecting some incoming traffic for the by JVM request. It asks Kubernetes to provision on the fly a new deployment. But then Kubernetes can't because it will make the memory limit to exceed the current memory limit. 300 plus 300, we will be over the hard limit of 500 MB. So what we need to do? We need first to step down the hello service in JVM mode. This should happen in a few seconds because it's in status terminating. And as such, it will be freed in a few seconds. And after that, we will have the request for the by JVM service, which should be pending. And then a new deployment should be provisioned on the fly. And we will see that our request is okay, has taken by JVM. Okay, so our request is has taken very long, something like 60 seconds. So the key point here is that you don't have any choice actually for this. It's either your HTTP client is waiting, and here we have seen that the request takes very really long time, or you pay in order to have more memory. So in a way, it's either delay or dollar. And that's it for the memory effect. Time to move to a conclusion. So I hope that now you have a better idea of how to use Camel Quarkus. We have reviewed some features. Kim says, so this is not only Java. Java is really popular, but we can also use Camel Quarkus with other DSL. We have seen the REST DSL implemented in XML here. You can customize by using custom Java code, and you can even mock the bins. It's possible to tune component. We have seen the way to tune component by code and by configuration. Native is awesome, but it comes with some extra concern. We have seen the good and the bad, I think. It's not really magical, actually. It's just a different choice. And with the last deployment, with Knative and demand deployment with memory constraints, I hope that we have seen that there is a trade-off between, in a way, the memory is costly, and the time to answer the first request. And these are key metrics. And in a way, this is things that should be taken into account when deciding for the native mode or not. I think in this environment, native mode could be good if you can spend some time in order to build. Okay, but Camel Quarkus, the key really aspects, and if we retain only this for today, it's really good. This is lightweight pattern-based integration running in the cloud. Many thanks for attending. I will try to push the tiny URL links into the chat. If you have any question, we can try to answer them right now. But in any case, feel free to reach out to the Camel community. We have the Zulip chat, and we really love to understand from people from the cloud, I would say. Many thanks.